going to do is start a series. If you're not familiar, I like to interact. It's not going to be so much of a lecture, hopefully. Hopefully you'll interact and get involved so we can all learn. You know, the Bible says iron sharpens iron, and so that's what we want to do. If you're not familiar with the way that I teach, sometimes I seem antagonistic when somebody gives an answer. I'm not being antagonistic. I'm just giving a response that some people have given me, and so we're sort of working things out loud, you know, as far as what we believe. So what we're going to look at is Revelation chapters 21 and 22. You can turn there so that you say you did. We're not going to get that far this morning. Revelation chapter 21 and 22, I will read verse 1 just so that I can say that I read it. And then I'll give you some introduction that is much needed, right? So I've entitled this series, There's No Place Like Home. I got that phrase from a well-known Kansas theologian. There's no place like home. You know, there's coming a day when we'll no longer have to deal with all the things we deal with. And yet we don't talk about that. We don't talk about what it's going to be like. We don't talk about what we're going to be doing. We don't talk about where it's at. And I like to ask people what they like to learn about, because the last time somebody gave me the opportunity to choose what I wanted to study, I chose Leviticus. And I made it interesting, I guess. I don't know. That was the last time I got my opportunity to pick what I wanted to teach, though. But so that's what I usually do, and then people tell me what they would like to learn and study. And so this past time, I did the same thing. And the overwhelming response was, we want to do something prophetic. And so I talked to the elders about it, and they said, let's do the new heavens and the new earth. And so that's what we're going to do, the new heavens, new earth, and the new Jerusalem. Let me read Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven, the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Now, because there's various people hold various views as to what the new heavens and the new earth and the New Jerusalem means, we need to lay down some groundwork, or give you some propositions to think about before we get into our study. I've given you one chart. I'll give you a bunch of different charts. This is just generally how I view it. It's a very general outline. You may, of course, not realize it, but not everyone would agree with just this very general outline that I've put up there, and that's okay. We're here together, and we'll all end at the same place, and we can work out our understanding of the prophetic passages that we're going to deal with in our class. This is your opportunity. You know, normally when a pastor is up there preaching, and you might have questions as to some things he says, you can't really stop him in the middle of his sermon and say, hey, what about this or that? Here, you can do that. So I would encourage you to do that if you want to, all right? So before I do this, let me just say this. I take the Bible as literally as possible. Unless it's otherwise stated, when I read the scriptures, I read it as literal as possible, which means that when we're going to start talking about the new heavens and the new earth, I don't believe that it's a state of mind. I believe it's a real literal place. The New Jerusalem, I believe, will be a real literal place. I don't believe, therefore, that it is a state of mind. You say, well, who would believe that? Well, there's a lot of people who believe that. Well-known, he passed away, but a well-known self-proclaimed spiritual leader by the name of Wayne Dyer said that heaven is a state of mind, not a location. Writer John Burroughs says much the same thing. Heaven is not a place, but a state of mind. Self-proclaimed spiritual guide, spiritual leader of today, says this: my idea of heaven is a great big baked potato and someone to share it with. The same spiritual leader says, rather than finding heaven on earth, we're asked to release heaven while living on earth. Anybody know who said that, who tweeted that? Oprah Winfrey. Now, I know you're saying, well, of course, these people believe it's a state of mind, but what about within Christendom? the professing realm of Christianity. Well, roughly half or fewer the Hindus, Buddhists, and Jews don't believe in a heaven. Now, if you think about that, just the Hindu population, there's over 870 million. That's 870 million people who don't believe in the eternal state of things. That doesn't include the millions in Nepal and Bangladesh and Indonesia and Pakistan. There are 2 million practicing Hindus in the U.S. alone, and they don't believe in a heaven, right? They don't believe in a heaven. And that's, of course, according to the World Atlas. Some believe it's a state of mind. I don't believe it's a state of mind. This also means, because I take it literally, that I also don't believe that the New Jerusalem is the church. Now, don't get mad at me. There may be some in here that do believe that the New Jerusalem is the church. The Eastern Orthodox Church, which is a large body of professing within Christendom, professing Christians, teaches that it is an icon, that is the church, the Greek Orthodox Church, or a symbol or a representative of the new or the heavenly Jerusalem. So they believe that they are the New Jerusalem, right? And by the way, anytime that you want to stop me and interact, maybe have questions or comments, just go right ahead and do that. The New Jerusalem played an important theme also in the colonialization of the New Englanders of the 17th century by the Puritans, right? The Puritans, they saw themselves as builders of the New Jerusalem, right? That's the foundation to American nationalism. Were they the New Jerusalem? I don't think so. Are we in the New Jerusalem? Some people say, by a show of hands, how many of you know that there are religious groups that believe that we are in the New Jerusalem right now? Right? We've passed through the tribulation. We've passed through the second coming. We've passed through the Messianic kingdom, the great white throne judgment. Satan has been destroyed, and there are some who believe we are in the eternal state. I told somebody the other day, if we are, we're in the slum section, I think. Now, don't get mad at me again if you believe that. I'm just teasing. The LDS, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, which is kind of like grape nuts. Neither grapes or nuts. They're neither Christians or saints. They believe that the New Jerusalem will be a physical kingdom that'll be built in North America, centered on Independence, Missouri. That's in their own teachings, their own writings, the Doctrine and Covenants 57 and verse 2. So they believe that it will be a literal place and they will establish it. The Jehovah's Witness also believe that the New Jerusalem is the church of the 144,000 based on Revelation 3:12 and chapter 21 and verse 2, which says, "And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as," again, comparative language, "as a bride adorned for her husband." And so they teach that the New Jerusalem is the church, of course, the church of Jesus or of the Jehovah's Witness group, or the 144,000. That's based on their insights on the scriptures of page 496. So there are many different people who believe this. Roman Catholicism, New Jerusalem is already exists as a spiritual community in heaven. The church triumphant with the outpost on earth, the church militant. You say, well, Jeff, I'm not Jehovah's Witness. I'm not, a Mormon. I'm not Greek Orthodox. I'm not Roman Catholic. I hold more of a Reformed view. Anybody care to guess what the Reformed view is? Who knows what the Reformed view of the New Jerusalem is? Anyone? Herman, and I hope I'm pronouncing his name right. I meant to ask Andrew. Andrew reads quite a bit of him. Herman Bavnik, in his Reform Dogmas, it's a bunch of commentaries on that. His view is also that the New Jerusalem is the church triumphant. The church triumphant, right? The church in heaven. Of course, so that means it's a non-literal view, obviously. And you'll find this outlined in a famous church father's book called The City of God. Anybody know who that is? Augustine or Augustine. Are you guys awake? Yeah, Laura. Well, since I take this literally, the new heavens and the new earth, I don't believe it's a state of mind. I don't believe the New Jerusalem is the church. I also don't believe that the New Jerusalem is the future messianic temple. Now, how many of you understand what I'm talking about when I talk about the messianic temple? Ezekiel chapters 40 to 48 describe a period of time in which a temple is going to be rebuilt. Zechariah chapter 6 verses 12 to 14 say that the Messiah is going to build that temple. It'll be the messianic temple during the messianic kingdom. Somebody give me another word or phrase for messianic kingdom you might be more familiar with. The millennial kingdom or the millennial reign. Now, some also today believe that we are in now the millennial kingdom. You understand that, right? Some of you understand it, right? Okay. Any questions so far or comments? Oh, y'all are quiet. I'm going to have to start antagonizing you a little bit here. All right, so now that we looked at what I don't believe here, let me give you the interpretation of what I believe the New Jerusalem is. And this isn't just mine. There are many other people, Dr. Wolver, people that you might know, John MacArthur, Charles Ryrie, people like that would believe the same thing. So I believe the New Jerusalem is a literal capital city of the new heavens and new earth, which in which all the redeemed of all the ages will dwell throughout all eternity, serving God in their glorified bodies. Right? Now, again, not everybody believes that. But that is what we're going to teach. That's the way that we're going to teach this new heavens and the new earth this morning, or as we get to it. So let me go back again now to the beginning and lay some groundwork as to why there's such a difference between people who believe that this is a literal future event or a past event. So let me give you several propositions. The first one is the hermeneutical principle. Now, by hermeneutical principle, I mean many of you guys have glasses, right? I can't hardly see much of anything without my glasses as far as reading goes. So think of the word hermeneutics as a pair of glasses. It's how you see the scripture. It's how you see the teaching of the scripture. God has communicated to us using understandable language. And yes, there are various what we call genres of speech in the Bible, such as prophecy and poetry and history. This understandable language is also the subject of prophecy. Let me give you an illustration of what I mean. Look at Daniel, the book of Daniel. Daniel's a prophetic book. And look over in chapter 9. Good place to look. Some people don't like prophecy because they say, well, you can't understand prophecy. Now, it's interesting. What is the title of the book that we're going to be studying out of? What's the title of the book we're going to be studying out of? Revelation. What's another word for revelation? What's the Greek word? You guys know it. Apocalypsis, right? What does that mean? The unveiling. The unveiling. Why would God choose to title the book The Unveiling of Jesus Christ if it wasn't understandable? But some people say prophecy is not understandable, and so they make it a secondary issue and they don't want to study it. Daniel chapter 9 is just one of the many places where there is a lot of prophetic things going on. But I want you to notice just several phrases. Look at chapter 8 and the last verse there, verse 28. Or 27, excuse me. And I, Daniel, fainted and was sick for days. Afterward, I rose and went about the king's business. I was astonished by the vision, but no one understood it. Right? So look at verse 2. In the first year of his reign, speaking of Darius, I, Daniel, understood by the books the number of the years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. So one of the ways that Daniel understood prophetic interpretation was through the scripture. Now, Daniel prays. It's toward the end of the 70 years. He wants to know what's going on. God dispatches an angel to him. And what does the angel tell him? Oh, Daniel, don't worry about it. You won't understand it. That's not what he tells him at all. Look down there in chapter 9 at verse 22. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I have now come forth to give you what? Skill to understand. See that? Then he gives them the 70-week prophecy, or what's another word for that or phrase for that that you might be more familiar with? The tribulation period. The 70-week prophecy, or the 70th week of Daniel. Look at verse 23. Know therefore and what? Understand. Understand, right? Verse 23 tells him the same thing. Down at the bottom, at the beginning of your supplications, the command went out, and I've come to tell you, for you greatly beloved, therefore, consider the matter and understand the vision. Understand. You're saying the same thing in chapter 10 and verse 1, where twice, and he understood the message and had understanding of the vision, right? So you see the same thing if you go to chapter 10, verses 11 and 12 and 14. Understand. He understood. There is nothing, no reason why we should not study prophecy, especially the book of the Revelation, when it tells us what is our future, what our future is. God wrote his word, give his word to men in understandable language, and that includes prophecy. And he gave it to us to understand it and to be encouraged by it and to know what's ahead, right? So what is the hermeneutical principle then that we use? We use the literal, historical, grammatical interpretation of Scripture. Literal, historical, grammatical. We take it literally as possible. This is what was taught in our theological academy by Andrew. We take the literal, historical, grammatical approach to interpretation of Scripture unless the text otherwise demands it. So let me give you another proposition here, if there's no comments and questions about that. There are mainly two hermeneutical methods in studying and interpreting Old Testament prophecies. There are basically two methods for studying. Now, you say, oh, wait a minute, you said Old Testament prophecy. What does that have to do with studying the book of the Revelation? Well, did you know that there are over 270 indirect references to the Old Testament in the book of the Revelation? So if you don't understand the Old Testament, you're probably missing quite a bit when you get to the book of the Revelation if you just try to read it and understand it, right? It's also been said that there's over 27% of the Bible is prophetic, according to Barton Payne in his Encyclopedia of Biblical Prophecy. Over 27%. Well, what do you do with that? Just don't read and try to interpret the prophecy? No, you can't do that. You have to deal with the prophetic passages, right? So here's the two approaches. You have what we call, first of all, the Christocentric method. I don't know if you guys are familiar with these terms, in which you see they use the literal, historical, grammatical, but it's through Christ. In other words, they find the fulfillment of all Old Testament passages. They're taught to find the fulfillment of all Old Testament passages in the person and work of Christ in the New Testament. Are you with me? You understand what I'm saying? Now, I want you to think through that, because that has some interesting ramifications if you do that. One of the proponents of the already but not yet method, if you've ever heard that phrase, is a guy by the name of George Eldon Ladd. I really like him, got a lot of his books. Of course, I differ with him on things, but I want to read for you just a couple of statements that, so that you can understand this, and then I'll give you a question and try to help you see the application of this. All right? Now, I realize this isn't, you know, Noah and the Ark in a basic Bible Sunday school class, but, you know, you guys are, I think, are pretty well versed in all the basic stuff, right? So I'm going to stretch your mind a little bit, hopefully. So listen to what he says here. He's quoting, talking about the two different views, and he's talking about the view that he now holds, which is the Christocentric view. And he says the Old Testament must be interpreted and often reinterpreted by the new revelation given in the person and mission of Jesus Christ. Right? So in other words, you don't take the Old Testament prophecies literally. You look for them as being fulfilled in what who Jesus was and what he did in the New Testament. Okay? Now you say, well, how do you get that from there? Well, just because of what he continues to say in his book concerning this. He says on page 17, but precisely here is our basic hermeneutic. Jesus, he says, and the apostles after him, which I think this is a false statement, but he says, reinterpreted the Old Testament prophecies in light of Jesus' person and mission. You see what he says? In other words, the Old Testament, I'll give you an example. The Old Testament prophecy that we spoke of in Daniel, Daniel chapter 9, talks about possibly one or two princes. If you will, go back there if you aren't still there in Daniel chapter 9, and I'll show you what I'm talking about here. Go back to Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9 gives us a timetable, and these are very important in Scripture, these timetables. He gives, starting in verse 24, I want you to notice what he says. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city, right? Gabriel is talking to Daniel. So who is Daniel's people? Israel, the Jews. And what is Daniel's city? Jerusalem. So what is the prophecy concerning? Daniel's people, the Jews, and Daniel's city, Jerusalem, right? That's what Gabriel has given him this interpretation and telling him you're to understand it like this. 70 weeks are determined for your people and your city to finish the transgression, make an end of sin, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up the vision of prophecy, to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand, and now he gives you a time to start, that from the going forth of the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, that's Nehemiah 2, until the Messiah the Prince shall be 70 weeks and 62 weeks, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, or 79 weeks, or series of 7 years. The street will be built again, and the wall, even in troublesome times. And after the 62 weeks, which is the 69, Messiah will be cut off. That's the crucifixion. But not for himself. And the people of the Prince who is to come shall destroy the city and sanctuary. Now, are there one or two princes in this section of Scripture? Some say there's only one prince. It's Jesus. But I want you to notice what it says here. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now, let me skip over something and read this to you and ask you a question. You got your thinking caps on? Are you ready? You don't sound ready. All right. Well, somebody might be ready. And the people shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now, who destroyed the city of Jerusalem and the sanctuary in AD 70? The Romans. Notice, then back up then and notice what it says. The people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Was Jesus not a Jew? Of course he was a Jew. Which means he was not what? A Roman, a Gentile, which means there are two princes in this passage. But if you interpret it according to, if you use the interpretation that this person and many other people are promoting, that you see all Old Testament prophecies fulfilled in the person and work of Jesus, then it's not a future Antichrist you're looking at, it's Jesus Christ in the past. You see that? You understand that? That's why it's important that you understand there are two methods of looking at this. One, because there, I will show you, there's one method already that says we are in eternity right now. There's other methods that say we're in the Messianic kingdom right now, as well as the tribulation right now. Well, where do they get that, you might say? It's how you view the Scripture. And by the way, This will affect you depending on if you're using a study Bible. Whose study Bible are you using? Right? Okay, any thoughts so far or questions? I could read more out of here, but for time's sake, I don't think I'm going to. I think you get the idea. No questions. You got everything I'm saying, right? So if I call on anybody, you'll be able to tell me, right? The answer to the question. Okay. I hope that this doesn't seem boring to you, but this is extremely important because we're to study to show ourselves approved unto God, right? Workmen that needs not to be shamed. Matter of fact, I think Awana teaches that, don't they? You want to send your kids here, and the very slogan that says they're to study to show themselves approved, we're not going to do it. Come on. We are to do it, right? And this is part of it, Bill. So if nothing else, it'll be me and you right here. Nobody else may come back, but it'd be me, Bill, and Megan. Well, she makes me drive separate, so it might be just you and I. Yeah, Carrie? You'll be here too? That's wonderful. There'll be three of us anyway. Okay. Let me ask you this, because I don't know where everybody is in their understanding of things, okay? There are what we call four, there are various covenants in the scripture. I hope I write this big enough. There are what we call four unilateral or unconditional covenants in the scripture. Do you know what they are? Somebody give me one that's been preached on out here for several weeks now. The Abrahamic covenant. Good. I was hoping you got that. So the Abrahamic covenant was unconditional. That means God did not depend. There was nothing Abraham had to do to fulfill the obligations. You remember in Genesis 15, God passed between the parts, obligating himself to fulfill the conditions. Unconditional. That means when God promised Abraham the three things he promised him, which was land, seed, and blessing, God covenanted himself to make sure that that came to pass. All the obligation was God took upon himself. Are you with me so far? Okay, what was the other one, the other unconditional covenant? What's that? The Davidic covenant. God said, I'm going to set a descendant of yours, King David, on the throne. That fulfills Genesis 49:10. And he would rule over the house of Jacob forever. Right? Genesis chapter 49, verse 10 is the first time it's prophesied of this king who will come. And then it begins to narrow down the line to where it gets to Mary. And Mary's told, you're going to give birth to a son. He'll rule over the house of Jacob forever. Right? Isaiah 9, 6, and 7 talks about his kingdom as having no end. God is going to perform that. Right? It wasn't dependent on whether David was faithful or not. It was dependent upon God to fulfill that. Now, one of the ones, and I'm just going to give it to you, that you might not notice and you might not see is the land covenant. You'll find that in Deuteronomy 29, verse 1 through 30, verse 10. And in chapter 30, verses 1 through 10, it gives you the conditions in which Israel will be in order to fulfill that part of the covenant, to enjoy that. Because the conditional covenant they had, was the Mosaic covenant. That was conditioned. They had to obey in order to enjoy what they actually possessed. Does that make sense to you? God said, the land is yours, Abraham, and to your descendants forever. But if you read Deuteronomy 28 and 29 and Leviticus 26, the enjoyment of that was conditioned on their obedience. And you'll see that. Remember the Mount Gerizim and Nebo where you had the blessings and the cursings. If you obey me, I'll bless you. If you don't, I'll curse you. And then ultimately, I'll kick you off the land. Remember that? All right. That was conditioned on their enjoying that land, the Davidic covenant. Now, what was the last covenant? The new covenant. right? And what did the new covenant consist of? Just in your own words, tell me. What would God do in the new covenant? Ezekiel chapter 11, Ezekiel 36, Jeremiah 31, Hebrews chapters 8 through 10. What would God do that would be different from the old? In their hearts, right? He'll take out the heart of stone, put in a heart of flesh so that they will obey him. You remember that? Now, here's why I mention this. If you read the scriptures with a Christocentric pair of glasses, then Jesus has fulfilled all of those. Okay? Are you with me? Which means that he is now ruling and reigning. Which means all of you who are looking for a future literal kingdom are out of luck. Because the kingdom's now. The kingdom's the church. That's what you call what? Amillennialism. There's no literal, physical reign of Christ on the earth. He's ruling and reigning now in the hearts and minds of the believers here and in heaven. You with me so far? Now, you have to cover some of this to get to the eternal state, because the eternal state is the last thing. And God has a timeline, and he follows that timeline, right? And so are we, or Bill and I anyway, we'll follow it, you know. We'll let you know when I'm done, and you can come back. So whoever's going to teach next. Now, I know some people say, well, Christ is king. He is ruling and reigning. Now, somebody tell me, what is Jesus' threefold office? Jesus has a threefold office. You know what I mean by that? Okay, he has a threefold office. Give me the first one. Give me the first one. Prophet. When did he exercise that role? Yeah, when he was here on earth, right? What is the other aspect? Priest. He's prophet, priest. When does he exercise that? Now. Hebrews chapter 7, Romans chapter 8, verse 31. He exercises that now in heaven, right? He intercedes for us. Is that what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 7, 1 John 2, verses 1 and 2? He intercedes for us. That's his role now. And then what's his third role? King. And when will he exercise that role? I think when he comes back on earth. Now, I say that because not everybody believes that. Many people believe he's exercising that role as king now. So here's how you can tell. There are characteristics in each time period we're studying and we're going to cover. How does Jesus rule in the say this is the messianic kingdom. Say this is the millennial reign. How does the Bible say that Jesus rules when he is in that kingly office, exercising that kingly office? How does he rule? There's a certain phrase in the Old Testament and the New Testament that's used that describes how he rules with a rod of iron. Is that how Jesus is ruling you now? Whenever you sin, does he immediately judge you right now? Well, that's the characteristic of his messianic reign that's promised in the Old and New Testament. So if he's not, then you have a problem, don't you? You have to figure that out. But if it is future, when he sits upon the throne and he puts down any rebellion, that makes more sense to me. But I'm just saying, what I'm trying to show you is if you believe one thing, there are certain implications to what you believe, certain ramifications of what you believe, right? Certain consequences to what you believe. You say you're in the Messianic kingdom, okay? How does the scripture define and characterize the Messianic kingdom? Some people, and I'll show you a chart, Some people say that the Messianic kingdom is the same as the eternal kingdom, which, look at the characteristics and you will see that they're different. Well, let me give you this other perspective, and then we'll look at some other things here. You have the Christocentric perspective, which tries to find the fulfillment of Old Testament passages in the person and work of Jesus. Then you have what we call the Christotelic. The Christotelic comes to the last part of that word is from a Greek word telos, meaning finished or complete. And what it means is you're still using the literal, historical, grammatical method, plus Christ, who is the theme of the Old Testament. Jesus is the theme of the Old Testament. We see that in Luke 24, 27, in Luke 24, 44, John 5, 39, and several other passages. He is the theme of the Old Testament. But there's a difference between being the theme of the Old Testament and being the hermeneutic of the Old Testament. How many of you are lost right now and ready to go to church? Laura? At least you're honest. See, now that's a good question. If you're too timid to ask me, hey, what do you mean by Christocentric, Christotelic, hermeneutic, write those words down. Hermeneutic. I guarantee if you just start writing Herman, it'll give you eutic on there. E-U-T-I-C, hermeneutic. Now, what word were you to? Are you being silly? Or are you? Oh, what words were you talking about? All of them? I don't remember all of them. Oh. So, as I said before, depending on what lens you look at this through the scriptures at, is going to determine another thing here, right? And that is that here's a third proposition for you. There are four ways in which you'll look at the scriptures, right? You'll look at it through what we call a preterist viewpoint, a historic viewpoint, a futuristic viewpoint, or an idealistic viewpoint. Okay, I'll try to get an outline for you next week, and so that you can see some of the explanations of some of these definitions. Now, when we talk about looking at it through a preteristic viewpoint, who knows what that means? Preteristic. Anybody? I know some of you do. You just want to say. No, that's actually a compass too. Full preterist teach he's already come. Yes. Okay, now preterism is derived from the Latin term praetor, meaning past. So what they would say, a preterist would say, and there are many notable preterists, matter of fact, they're gaining ground today, that the promises of Israel find their fulfillment in the Christian church at the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. So all of Matthew 24, all of the book of the Revelation, all of that has already been fulfilled when the temple was destroyed. From the time Jesus came, the tribulation was going on. When Jesus began to teach in his ministry up until AD 70, that was the millennial kingdom. When he was crucified and rose, that's what began the eternal state. That's what a full preterist would teach. A full preterist. Yeah, Shannon. I don't know. Then probably. I don't know that for certain, because just like the CMA, Christian Missionary Alliance, they teach, not everyone teaches the same thing in Christian Missionary Alliance. Yeah, I don't know. For them, the new heavens and the new earth is synonymous with the kingdom of heaven. It's interpreted as the spiritual aspect of God's kingdom under the new covenant. Now, something else that I will show you. When you're talking about the kingdom, what are you talking about? When you're reading the scriptures, there are various aspects of the kingdom. Okay? There is what we call the universal kingdom, God's rule over all. Regardless, God rules over all, right? And I got you, there's verses up there. There's the spiritual kingdom, right? Jesus said, except you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Book of Colossians, Paul said, you were taken out of the kingdom, the domain of Satan, transferred, translated into the kingdom of his dear son at the new birth, right? The spiritual aspect. There's the theocratic aspect, when God rules his creation through man. That's what happened in the garden, right? God had man ruling creation for him, the theocratic aspect of the kingdom. There's the messianic or mediatorial kingdom. That's where what some of you call the thousand-year millennial reign, where Jesus literally rules with a rod of iron and reigns on a literal earth over restored Israel. And then there's the eternal kingdom, which follows, which is the subject of what we're going to study. So when you're coming across something and you're reading the kingdom, you have to understand, what are they talking about? The kingdom in what sense? Are you with me? Because if you don't, you can get yourself in a lot of trouble. Let me just give you a verse to think about. Matthew chapter 10, I think in verse 5 and 6. And 7. This is why you have to differentiate between what is being talked about as far as kingdom. And there are many other words as well that you have to differentiate here. But look at verse 5. And this is just one incident. There's other examples of this. These 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles. By the way, who are you guys? You're all Gentiles. Do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and don't enter into any of the city of the Samaritans, which were half-breeds, excuse my language, but they were Jewish and Gentile mix. But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of God is at hand, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That was Jesus and John's message, right? Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, the gospel, go forth and preach the gospel of the kingdom. Is that what we're doing today? Well, we can't be preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Why not? Because that was only to the Jews. We're preaching the gospel of personal salvation in Christ, right? But we're not offering the kingdom. That's what Jesus did when he first came. He offered the kingdom to Israel, and they rejected it. Now, you could think about that, and for next time, maybe have some questions, or Bill and I will talk about that next time. Yeah. Yes, and let me define gospel. But again, you have to define gospel. What does gospel mean? Good news. That's all it means. The good news that Jesus and John came preaching was the kingdom is here because the king is here. Now, meet the requirements for the kingdom, the Sermon on the Mount, and accept the kingdom, and they didn't, right? We're not preaching that. What we're preaching is what Christ has done in his sacrificial, in his substitutionary death, in the perfect life he lived, the substitutionary death he died, and God vindicating him in that and accepting, showing us that he accepted that by raising him from the dead. That's what we're preaching, the gospel. They didn't preach that then because Jesus was there. So it is different. No, it is substance. For example, when Jesus was with the disciples toward the end of his ministry, he said, the Son of Man is going to be betrayed, handed over to the kings and the rulers, and they're going to crucify him, and the third day he's going to rise. What was that right there that he told them? The gospel. According to Paul, right? The death, how Christ died, was buried, rose again, right? What was their response? They didn't get it. Matter of fact, Peter said, no, you're not going to die. You see? So the substance was different. You're thinking of gospel as a technical term meaning only salvation. Yeah, that's not what he was offering them. Yet the good news he was offering them was the king is here, accept the kingdom by meeting the requirements. And they said, no, you're not the king and you're not meeting the requirements. You're doing what you're doing by the power of the devil. Matthew chapter 12. And then after that, what do you have? Him preaching mystery parables of the kingdom. See that? Because they rejected him. It's a good question, though. Any other clarifications? Yeah. I don't know. I wouldn't dare. When they... Yeah, that's an excellent question. When they received Christ, when they believed in who he said he was. How's that? I'm not sure how you're equating the... Yeah, depending on what you mean by kingdom, sure. Yeah. So what are you meaning by kingdom? So then the question would be, when were they regenerated? When were they born again? So when would that have been? Or what would have been the evidence that they were born again? Well, how do you know that, though? I know, but how do you know I have the Spirit of Christ? Okay, their belief, right? Keep talking. Maybe it will. I'm not sure the direction you're trying to come from. Gotcha. Yes and no. Because how are you defining the kingdom? Remember? There are different aspects of the kingdom. Are we talking about the literal messianic kingdom, or are we talking about the sphere of God's rule? If we're talking about the sphere of God's ruling in our hearts, Jesus said, except you be born again, you can't see the kingdom. So you have to be born again before you can even understand it. And the fruit of that understanding is repentance and faith. So when they repented and believed, it gave evidence that they were saved. They were filled with the Spirit as evidence in at Pentecost. Because remember, Jesus said, I'm going to send you another comforter. But he said he cannot come until I ascend in John 7, 38 and 39. Okay? Yeah. Yeah, Jeff. Yes. And what you have to do when you're looking at the text is to understand what aspect of the kingdom that is being talked about. All right, Tom? And this is why I'm trying to do this the way I'm doing it. Because you can listen to John MacArthur and get one view, R.C. Sproul get another view, Kenneth Gentry and get another view. And you'll be confused more than when you got in here. But if you take these principles and apply them, it will help you more than reading this. this person's view and that person's view and that person's view. It could change. It could change the way you view stuff. Yeah. Well, all we're doing right now is I'm letting you see that you are viewing the scriptures either from a Christocentric viewpoint or Christotelic viewpoint. Because of that, you are either looking for a future kingdom, literal messianic kingdom, or you see it as happened in the past, or you see it now as spiritual. But all of these things depend upon your viewpoint. So once you get that basis down, then you can start digging into the prophetic. I think that's the mistake a lot of Christians make early on. They start reading one guy's perspective. Oh, yeah, I like this and that and that. Then they get another perspective. Oh, I like this and that. But now that's confusing because of this. And they're not taught how to study. That's all I'm trying to do is help you to learn how to study this. And then you can make up your own mind what you believe. Right, Bill? And what I'm trying to help you do is avoid that confusion and to give you some basic principles in how to study and look at things and to show you that you are looking at Scripture through a lens and help you to identify what that lens is, okay? One more, and then I have to let you go. I'll get in trouble. DeShannon? Telic? Yeah. Okay, I'll give you an example. The Ezekiel's temple. Ezekiel prophesies for 8 chapters of a future, supposedly future, literal temple in Jerusalem. If you look at that from a Christocentric viewpoint, you would say that's just the idealistic temple, or Jesus said that the temple is the church now. So what you're doing is you're looking for Jesus to fulfill an Old Testament prophecy, either in his person or work or in the church, us Christians, or a future literal. Yeah. So it's either future and literal because it's never happened in the past, or you have to, I hate to say it this way, you have to spiritualize it and make it something different. The Christotelic is you see the historical, literal, grammatical, and Christ at the end of it, which is it's going to be a literal future temple that's going to be built. Right, and Messiah will rule and reign, and the Jews will remember. The Jews will sacrifice just as we observe the Lord's Supper. It doesn't say it's a commemoration type thing. Yes, it'd be more literal. I can try to do that if you come back.